Unit 1, Lesson 1, Anglo-Saxons through the Anglo-Normans, giving you some background and talking about Beowulf. Many of today's traditional literary works reference King Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table. Readers need the knowledge of the Arthurian legends to fully understand British literature and historic Britain's social codes for knights, kings, and ladies of nobility. This lesson introduces the culture of the Anglo-Saxons and the Anglo-Normans, who transcribed oral traditions, Beowulf, and Sir Gawain and the Green Knight, are foundational pieces of English literature. These narratives demonstrate the characteristics of the epic, the romantic hero, and the ideas of chivalry. The epic tale formed the foundation for all British literature that followed. The foremost authority on the hero cycle, Joseph Campbell, discovered that patterns of one myth exist universally within all epic stories throughout the world. Campbell named this pattern the monomyth cycle, but scholars now call it the hero cycle. This lesson explains the traits of the hero cycle to enhance your understanding of the literary tradition. Scholars believe the Anglo-Saxon people originally came from Denmark and Germany, beginning in the early 5th century AD and continuing into the Norman conquests of 1066. Despite the formation of the Petocracy of seven kingdoms during this time period, the Anglo-Saxons experienced tremendous political upheaval and war. The Anglo-Saxons suffered countless Viking or Danish invasions. The only defense eventually came from the King of Wessex, also known as Alfred the Great. The king established a treaty with the Danes and created a united nation. The treaty kept the Danes and English separated geographically by giving the Danes the northern and eastern parts of England. In England today, the Scandinavian and Anglican influences remain, particularly within the multitude of English language variations spoken throughout the country. In the social atmosphere of the time, the main classes within the social hierarchy separated slaves and free men. Class distinctions within these two main groups created various levels of slaves and free men. The free men consisted of the king, the noblemen, and the freemen. The class differences established a werend, a man price, or the price of compensation received for homicide. Social class mobility allowed people to rise and fall within the class structure. This mobility even gave slaves the ability to join the ranks of the noblemen if they received their freedom. Despite their often barbaric and patriarchal society, Anglo-Saxon women actually maintained remarkable independence. Legal documents and public records of the time suggest that women could participate in legal transactions, which included owning property, singly and jointly with their husbands, swearing an oath, and receiving the same dowry as men of their social standing. During this time period, children often helped with the home and the farm. Families considered both boys and girls important and treated them equally. Childhood, however, did not last long. Between the ages of 10 and 12, children assumed the responsibilities of an adult and could marry and accept responsibility for crimes. Despite the harsh reality of war and invasions, the Anglo-Saxon people enjoyed recreational activities such as dancing, competitive sports, theater, dog and horse racing, acrobatics, and theater. Recreation focused on large feasts with the immediate and extended family. The culture centered around the community. The two most notable Anglo-Saxon traditions are the Morgengifu and the Weird. The Anglo-Saxon grooms gave their brides a Morgengifu, literally morning gift, upon waking from their first married night together. The bride kept the gift, it could be a jewelry, land, or sheep for life, even upon the death or divorce from her husband. The bride's acceptance of this gift made the marriage official. Weird means the role of fate. Stemming from their pagan beliefs, the Anglo-Saxons believed fate interceded in life based on the actions of the person. Actions could alter the course of events. According to Stephen Pollington, the analogy of the spider web helps explain Weird. A spider web catches prey within the intricately woven web. Once the web ensnares the prey, the entire web vibrates to alert the spider of the catch. The spider's dinner depends on whether it has woven the web correctly and whether or not its prey can escape. Additionally, the spider's quick actions will determine the fate of the prey. The web represents Weird, or fate, but what the actors do in response decides the outcome. And as a side note, the modern word weird comes from this ancient word. Whereas weird means odd or unusual, the predecessor weird has more to do with the supernatural. The original settlers of Britain were mostly of Germanic descent, and these settlers brought pagan practices to the country. The country's conversion to Christianity most likely occurred during the 7th and 8th centuries. Despite their conversion to Christianity brought on by Pope Gregory, the Anglo-Saxons continued to hold true to some of their pagan ways, which resulted in a blending of the two religions. For example, King Ethelbert of Kent insisted on meeting with St. Augustine, one of Pope Gregory's missionaries, outside under the open sky to prevent the missionary from performing sorcery. Even after the king converted to Christianity, he still maintained a pagan shrine next to his Christian altar. Eventually, Christianity dominated, and the Anglo-Saxons blended their symbolism, drinking rituals, and sacrifices into folklore, spinning tales of magic and rituals. Anglo-Saxons most likely passed down folklore through oral traditions. Social life within Anglo-Saxon culture centered on the great feast of the Mead Hall, or the Great Hall. The king and his subjects gathered in the Great Hall to enjoy food and drink, while poets and harpists entertained them. The entertainers sang or recited poetry that told the history of the Anglo-Saxons. Scribes, who trained in monasteries, likely transcribed the history that the poets and the harpists told, which means that the written versions of Beowulf blends Christian elements with pagan history. Epics focus on a serious situation that requires a hero to go on a quest to correct the situation through heroic deeds significant to a culture or society. Epics first appeared as poetry in their original language and still appear today in movies, music, novels, and comic book. Epics draw on the cultural heritage of the locations from which they hail, and they include details specific to their place of origin and time period. Listed below here is a table giving you some information about epic tales and epic heroes. You'll see under epic tales that they begin in medias res. That means it begins in the middle of the action. Epic tales were once written originally as long poems. Epic tales contain an epic hero. Epic tales, the characters in the epic tales reflect the epic's location, national legend, or historical figures. In an epic tale, you're going to see supernatural forces intervene to help the character succeed. And an epic tale encompasses a grand scope, not just one location. It would be an entire, not just one city, it would be an entire country, or perhaps the entire world as we know it. Some characteristics of epic heroes. They have supernatural abilities or qualities. Epic heroes are on some type of quest. Epic heroes are tested for their worthiness to complete the quest. They receive help from mythical or magical beings or other helpers along their journey. The epic heroes question their abilities and their worthiness after their interaction with their enemy. And the goal of the epic hero is to attain a position of power. As you see here, this is a artistic representation of what we call the hero's journey or the monomyth cycle from Joseph Campbell. You see you'll see that the hero starts at the very top with a call to adventure. Then he gets some help, and then he goes into the unknown, and that's where he meets his challenges and temptations. Something happens, he meets his critical mass point, his worst enemy. He has to face that enemy, and he overcomes. And then he comes back home and he shares what he has learned. And that's the basic gist of the hero cycle. Most scholars consider Beowulf, the oldest existing piece of British literature, to be the foundational epic of English and British literature. The epic tale originated between 700 and 800 AD, and Anglo-Saxons first shared it in their language, Old English. The tale most likely began as an epic poem or a series of short tales woven together. Anglo-Saxons used oral tradition to pass these tales through the generation. Bards, or poets, often told the tales during feasts in the mead halls, and scribes wrote down the story sometimes between the 8th and 11th century, but it remained unpublished until 1815. The original manuscript did not include a title, but people call it Beowulf after the hero in the tale. The Beowulf epic tells a warrior story about the Anglo-Saxon ancestor who lived in Denmark before the arrival of the Danes in medieval Europe. Beowulf meets the epic tale qualifications because the story uses an extended narrative poem to recount actions, travels, adventures, and heroic episodes. The narrative begins in medias res and features the epic hero Beowulf. The story includes a hero and a quest to battle evil and the ultimate quest to discover self. While the language of the epic may seem foreign to readers, a close examination of the plotline reveals a very familiar pattern. The story of Beowulf reflects the warrior culture of the Danes and epitomizes medieval Europe through classic battle scenes, displays of codes of honor, and stories of adventure. Stories of battle serve both to entertain and to encourage. People did not enter into battle lightly or with fear, but rather with reverence and honor. The code of the Germanic hero included values similar to the modern U.S. Army's motto of duty, honor, and country. The medieval code for heroes, on the other hand, emphasized strength, courage, and honor. To ascribe to the heroic code, if a man could ascribe to this heroic code, it would show his noble and ethical nature and prove that he possessed hospitality, loyalty, and generosity.